In the name of Allah, the most gracious, most merciful, I greet you all in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace and blessings be with you all. This program, entitled Reason, is used to reason to ourselves and to others the beauty of the Holy Quran, its supremacy above all other books, and its divine nature and divine language. The Holy Quran is a book that has never been looked at by an objective person, and it was rejected. And I recall I was visiting the University of Cambridge many years ago, and suddenly I was faced by a conference on modern linguistics. And I'm not interested in modern linguistics, but by the grace of Allah, my eyes picked up a lecture on the difficulty of translating the Holy Quran into a European language. So I went to attend that lecture, and I found an elderly professor, a very respectable man, speaking about the difficulty of translating the meanings of the Holy Quran from Arabic into English. And the man spoke about the Quran with great emotion, with great knowledge, with great respect. And he showed with many examples how difficult it is to commit the Holy Quran to a language other than the Arabic language, the divine language. After the lecture, I went to him and congratulated him for a wonderful lecture, which I enjoyed thoroughly. And I asked him, what made you speak about the Quran? He said, I'm a Muslim, and my wife is a Muslim, and my family have all embraced Islam. This man is Professor T.B. Irving. He used to be a professor of modern linguistics at the University of Tennessee in the USA. And when I asked him, how did you embrace Islam? He said, I was doing my PhD on the Spanish language. And I noticed that many, many words in the Spanish language are originally Arabic words. So I tried to study Arabic so that I can understand the meanings of these words. And I found that the Arabs do not speak proper Arabic language. And someone directed me to read the Quran. He said, read the Quran so that you can pick up the language properly. So I bought a copy of the translations of the meaning of the Quran. I started reading it first of all in English. Then I started reading it in Arabic, and this compelled me to study the Arabic language. And once I read it in Arabic, I couldn't resist embracing Islam. This shows how reasonable Islam is, how rational Islam is, how intellectual Islam is, and shows the moderation of the Holy Quran, the supremacy of the Holy Quran, the correctness of the Holy Quran, the authenticity of the Holy Quran. That's why we are here today in this program to speak to you about a verse in chapter 86, Surah At-Tariq. At-Tariq in Arabic means the knocker. And actually, this fits beautifully for a phase in the development of stars. We have what we call neutron stars or pulsating neutron stars. And these pulsating neutron stars give noise that simulates exactly somebody knocking at the door. And for the Holy Quran to speak about pulsating stars 14 centuries ago, and these pulsating stars were not discovered except in the latest phases of the 20th century, 1980-something, is something absolutely miraculous. And in this short surah, we have a large number of scientific facts that are purely scientific, that are correctly scientific, that are precisely stated in the surah. One of these verses is an oath given by وَالْأَرْضِ ذَاتَ الصَّدْعَ, by the earth that has got its own folds, its own ruptures, its own cracks along which movement can take place. And one would wonder, why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give that oath? But as we mentioned repeatedly, that when a Quranic verse comes in the context of an oath, this is a way of directing our attention to the greatness and the importance of the matter by which the oath is given. These cracks in the earth must be an essential factor for making the earth suitable for living. And before I indulge with commenting on this verse, I would like to ask my friends here, the young ladies and the gentlemen, to tell us their reflection when they first read this verse, وَالْأَرْضِ ذَاتَ الصَّدْعِ, by the earth that has got its own fractures along which movement can take place. And before I do that, I would like to emphasize that if a crack does not entail any movement, it's a crack or a joint. But if it entails movement, it's a fault. And a fault is a crack in the earth along which movement can take place, whether this is a horizontal movement or a vertical movement. So we will start with Manal to tell us her reflections about this verse, وَالْأَرْضِ ذَاتَ الصَّدْعِ.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In this surah, God is making a duration about all the miracles he gave to us on earth and in heaven, all these miracles which we see. Like the earth, when we talk about earth and it cracks, when we look long time ago, the earth was a solid mass and afterwards it cracked, and now we have the seas and ocean we use and we move in and we use for fishing and so on. So this is the bigger crack which happened long time ago, but nowadays we have every day and every minute smaller cracks for the plants coming out from the earth, for using of the humans and cattle and so on, like vegetables and plants and spices and herbs and all these things for using for the humans. And this is something very important for us, and this is why we say Subhanallah.
Barakallah fiki. And Osama?
Bismillah ar-Rahim at first. Actually, I wanted to emphasize also something, that there is a relation between the creator and the creature. When the creator gave an oath with his, when the creator gave an oath with his God, or with his deity, or with Allah, we say, Wallahi al-Azim, I mean this with this oath, I mean that I'm asking for the strength of the God, or the strength of this deity. Yeah. And also when the deity gave an oath with his creature, he is revealing and is emphasizing his strength and his power and his mightness in this creature. So that when God say, وَالْأَرْضِ ذَاتَ الصَّدْعِ, and in most of this surah, always God adjurate and give oaths with his creatures. وَالسَّمَاءَ وَالطَّارِقَ وَالْأَرْضِ وَهَكَذَا, and so on. So when the God says, وَالْأَرْضِ ذَاتَ الصَّدْعِ, he means here the God, ذَاتَ الصَّدْعِ, that is, he's revealing his mightness and his strength in the صَدْعِ, or in the faults. So why the faults? The faults doesn't occur in the earth, except in the earthquakes and the volcanoes. As we say that the crust or the crust of the earth is with several layers, and below this there is the magma or the molten rocks under this. Yeah. So the strength, I think that the God wants to reveal his strength or his mightness in his creature, which is full of strength. And as the creator is higher than the creature, so even if the creature has a strength, so the God is more strong.
Barakallah fi.
So that's.
And Khalid,
just want to comment on one thing. It's how beautiful is our Quran, mashallah. If you link, everything is linked together. The surah, as you rightly said, is called the knocker, and which is knocking, saying, try to understand what's in the verse.
Yes.
Don't try, just read it and try to understand what's behind it.
Yes.
So it's basically try to understand what's this when we say, well, al-zat sadh, the fault, it means something behind it. So you have to study it and try to analyze what's behind it.
Yes.
And it's also very much related to the verse after that, innahu laqawlu fasl, which means that it's these words are going to be separating between believers and unbelievers. So people have to look into what's behind the words, and you have to decide for yourself if you really believe in God and if you believe in Quran and how beautiful it is. It's all links and all coming together.
Barakallahu fiik. So this short verse, وَالْأَرْضِ ذَاتَ الصَّدْعِ, by the earth that has got its own folds, its own cracks along which movement can take place. As Manal quite justifiably said, it is these cracks along which movement took place were the sources of the formation of the ocean basins. And without ocean basins, the water of the earth, the hydrosphere, could have covered the earth in full, and man and animals and the plants could have never found any piece of land to live on. And that's why these faults were the main reason for shaping the surface of the earth into depressed areas and highly elevated ones. Without this topography, the earth could have never been inhabitable. Secondly, along these faults, both the atmosphere and the hydrosphere of the earth were formed, were generated. So water vapor came along volcanic activity, and this was mainly along these fault lines. They come also along volcanic vents, but mainly along these lines. So both the atmosphere and the hydrosphere of the earth were formed through these cracks. Not only this, we came to realize that these faults are very deep. They cut across the outer rocky layer of the earth completely. They are 65 kilometers deep at the bottoms of oceans and seas, and they are 150 kilometers deep on land. And these cracks or faults, or cracks along which movement can take place, are actually safety valves for the earth, because the earth has got many radioactive elements right in its inside. And these radioactive elements, Allah has given them the capacity to decay spontaneously. And they decay at certain rates. And as they decay, they generate heat. And unless this heat found a safety valve through which it would be released peacefully and gently, the earth could have exploded as a huge atomic bomb at the very moment of the solidification of its outer crust. And that's why Allah is showing his bounties upon man by these cracks, by these faults. Unless these faults were there, life on the surface of that planet could have been impossible. So Allah has given the oath by one of his creation, the faults of the earth, the cracks along which movement can take place, the faults that have shaped the topography of the earth, raised some to high peaks and depressed some to low-lying areas. And we now know that all oceans, all seas have initially started by rift systems, deep faults that would crack the earth, and then the magma would come along these cracks to push the sides of the continent away from each other, and longitudinal seas like the Red Sea would be gradually enlarged into oceans like the Atlantic Ocean or the Indian Ocean. How marvelous, how wonderful, how these simple lines can testify to the wisdom, knowledge, and might of the Creator. And that's why the oath is given by them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he mentions an oath in the Holy Quran, it's a way of directing our attention to the importance of the matter by which the oath is given. And that's why we realize today that the faults of the earth, the cracks of the earth along which movement takes place, is an essential factor for making our planet inhabitable and suitable for living. Not only this, but as Manal also mentioned quite justifiably, early commentators in the Holy Quran, when they first read this verse, they limited it to the slight cracks formed in the soils to allow a free passageway for the tender, gentle, germinating shoot that's coming from within a germinating seed. And unless Allah has given the soil of the earth this capacity to crack on watering, the earth could have never been suitable for any plantation. And if there were no plants, no animals, no plants and no animals, no life, no human beings, you see. And that's why, in a few words, Allah is showing his bounties upon us to encompass these cracks at the lowest scale, cracks of the soil, to allow a free passageway for a germinating seed, and the cracks at the bottoms of oceans and seas to create depressed areas, to encompass water bodies, to make seas and oceans, and at the same time to be free safety valves for allowing the great and immense quantities of heat that is generated at the core of the earth or in the inner part of the earth to be released peacefully, safely, and take with it not only the heat, but the water vapor that constitutes the hydrosphere, as well as the gases that constitute our atmosphere. So we can see in this, three words, a number of scientific facts that may take books to write on and to decipher and to explain. And this is one of the greatest qualities of the Quran, that a verse comes in a few words, and these few words contain an immense amount of knowledge, because it is the divine word in its divine purity and in its divine language. Nadine, to comment on what I have said and what the colleagues have said.
Okay, I was just imagining, what if these cracks or these faults are not happening while the seeds are coming out of the earth?
Yes.
So it's a little detail, but it's so important for these seeds to come out, for being plants or and for coming out trees and these things. It's so important. It's a little detail, but so important for us and for this creature to come out for living. So I think there is no comment after all what you said, and it's justifying, or it's showing how great Allah is, and that these little details we could never ever think about it so precisely, or so, I mean, this way.
In that detail. Barakallahu feek. And Neil.
The point I want to make about this verse, which caught my attention, is that this verse serves more than one purpose. It actually serves two purposes.
Yes.
As you mentioned, Allah doesn't need to take an oath. When he takes an oath upon himself, he's trying to draw the attention of human beings to the importance of what he's taking the oath with.
Yes.
So, and this, as you mentioned as well, is to show Allah's bounties on humankind.
Yes.
Without these faults or without these cracks, the formation of the entire hydrosphere or our atmosphere or the seas and the oceans wouldn't have taken place, and Earth wouldn't have been suitable for mankind. That was the first purpose of the verse.
Yes.
The second purpose, which is the Quran, when it was revealed, or the purpose of the Quran, is not a book of science.
Yes.
It is a book of guidance to human beings.
Yes.
However, there are around 1,000 verses talking about miracles in the Quran.
Yes.
And all of these miracles are like corroborating evidence to prove that this book is the word of Allah, and that everything in this book is 100% true. So it serves the purpose of being a scientific miracle that was not known to man at that time, that the earth was formed of different, that the earth contained these cracks at the bottom of the oceans and in the continents. And the second purpose is for human beings to think about all the bounties that that Allah has given to us, which led to the formation of such a suitable environment for human beings.
Barakallahu feekum. Not only this, but the verse also shows that the preparation of the earth to be a suitable planet for this wonderful life that's living on it is not a matter of chance or an accident. Actually, it needed very, very careful planning, and planning with a supreme being whose knowledge, might, and wisdom is beyond our own imagination. And that's why if we think only in the cracking of the soil to allow a free passageway for this tender, gentle shoot coming from within a germinating seed, we would be absolutely amazed, because, first of all, most of the soil is composed of what we call clay minerals. And these clay minerals are flaky minerals. And because they are flaky, very thin, they are flaky, they contain gases in between. And as you water the soil, the water expels these gases. So it pushes the soil upwardly until it thins out greatly so that it can crack. Not only this, but when you water a soil, you hydrolyze. You see, these clay minerals are very thirsty for water. Once you hydrolyze these clay minerals, they increase in size, and they cause them to bulge upwardly so that they can thin greatly and crack. Not only this, but we know that water is a dipolar molecule. It has got a positive end and a negative end. And these flaky minerals carry electric charges on top of their surfaces. So as water moves in, the similar charges actually push these clay minerals away from each other, So it helps also in the rising up of the soil. So the mere cracking of the soil to allow a free passageway for a germinating seed is a miracle by itself. Nobody can claim that this can be an accident or a chance or a matter of coincidence, you see. Secondly, these deep cracks, which go to 65 kilometers at the bottoms of seas and oceans and 150 kilometers deep, what energy can create this? Really, it testifies to the might, knowledge, wisdom, careful planning of the Creator, who created everything in a systematic manner so that man can understand the laws of creation and use them for making life on the surface of that planet a better life. So one of the essences of these cosmic verses in the Holy Quran is also to testify to the fact that nothing in this universe came by chance. Nothing in this universe came by an accident. Every single movement in the universe is very carefully calculated and very precisely designed. And this testifies for the presence of a creator with that knowledge, with that wisdom, with that might. This creator is above all his creation. Nothing in his creation looks like him. He is beyond the limitations of space and time, beyond the limitations of matter and energy, beyond any other limitations that can delimit man on the surface of that planet. And that's why these cosmic verses have to be understood in their scientific dimension, and the wisdom behind bringing them to us have to be fully understood. And that's why the following verse, as you quite justifiably said, إِنَّهُ لَقَوْلٌ فَصْلٌ. It's an emphasis that this word of Allah is the decisive word between right and wrong, between truthfulness and falsehood, because we are living in a world full of falsehood and full of wrong ideas and misconceptions and misbeliefs. And the Quran came to direct the attention of people to the fact that this creation is the product of a great creator, and this great creator is one without parallels, partners, or similitudes. He does not have any rivals. He does not have a wife and children. He is above that, because these are human qualities, and Allah is above all the qualities of his creation. So this exalted super being who has created this universe and everything that's in it is the only worthy of submitting to him in obedience and submitting to him in worship. And worship in Islam is twofold: worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the way he has prescribed, and worshiping him in being excellent vicegerents on earth, and advocating what's right and forbidding what's wrong, and establishing the divine justice on earth. And with this, we conclude, thanking you for your patience with us, hoping to meet again in another episode of this program, Reason. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace, mercy, and blessings be with you all.